Welcome to Mudwalkers. I'm Chris. If you're not already a Patreon member, check out the link in the description to support this channel financially. That would be awesome. It's unmonetizable on YouTube, so anything you can send my way would be great. So, yeah, what is this weird word you see in the title here? That's it's not an English word. Is it a name? What is it? So, as many of you know, I'm working on a conlang, which is short for constructed language, because I want to run the thought experiment of rewilding without the English language, because the English language is a very civilized language. It doesn't really have space in it for concepts like naturism or rewilding. It's not very good at describing these things or of expressing them. So I'm working on this conlang, and I've called it komi'u. So komi is a version of komeet, because the Komeet River locally here is where I really started to spread my wings in terms of rewilding. So it kind of became an important place to me sentimentally. So I named the language komi'u. So komi means komeet, and then the u on the end means from, sort of. It's like if you say American, the N on the end means it's from America. So in komi'u, you would say Amerika'u. You wouldn't say American. You'd say Amerika'u. So it's komi'u. So the language is of the komi'u. So the word for land in komi'u is taru. But taru doesn't just mean, you know, this stuff under our feet. It means the whole land. It's everything from the geology to the soil to the forests to the ecosystems, the rivers and lakes and streams, everything that's on the surface of the land as well. But taru can mean like continent. It can also mean the ground, but usually it is land with a capital L. It is the land. And that would mean, like, the way Daniel Vitalis says it is your bioregion. So like the Amazon rainforest, that whole rainforest is taru. It is one land. Then you have the Great Plains. That is also taru. That is a land. Then you have the southern rainforest where I live. That would be another taru. And you have the deserts out west. Those would be taru. So then you have the great amazing forest of the Pacific Northwest that I'm dying to get to one day, but it's on my bucket list. That is also taru. The tundra, taru. So all these different things. There's a saying in komi'u, sivisane taru. It means we must tend the land, not tend the dirt or the area. Tend the land with a capital L. The best example I can give of the kind of thing that I'm talking about with tending the land is Yellowstone Park. So Yellowstone Park, they extirpated wolves from the area years and years and years ago. And what they found is that as the wolf population was removed, the ungulate population exploded, and it damaged the ecosystem because the ungulates just got overpopulated. They went out of control, and the ecosystem began to degrade. So what they did was they got some wolves together, and they made a new population of wolves and put it back in Yellowstone Park. And they began to control the ungulate population, and it reshaped the forests. It diverted the paths of rivers, and the ecosystem breathed a sigh of relief. It had come back into balance, at least more than before. But as another example, let's say that there is a great example for where I am locally, wild hogs. Wild hogs are just a blight on taru, on this ecosystem, this bioregion on taru. They are wrecking the place. So part of my role as a tender of this land, Sanayomu Hutaru is to try and take out some of these hogs, try and reduce their population to try and save this ecosystem from the damage that they're causing. I'm looking forward to this summer because I just bought some supplies with my regular personal money, not Patreon money, just regular personal funds. I went and bought some supplies for a hog trap, and hopefully I'm going to start trapping some hogs for a friend here locally. And it's a, you know, it's a start. It's training wheels. It's not a very big trap. It's not very expensive or flashy. It's probably not going to be super effective, but it's a start. I think of all the things that I could focus on for tending the land where I am now, this bioregion, it's hogs. I think that's the main thing that I can contribute to right now is learning how to help control this population. Here in Louisiana, the number that the Department of Wildlife and Fisheries has put out is that in order to maintain hog numbers as they are, we have to kill 50% of Louisiana hogs every year. I guarantee you, we are not meeting that number. So hog populations are still exploding in Louisiana. And killing half of them is just to keep the population at its current numbers. That's just keeping them from growing. That's not progress. That's just maintaining. So, yeah. And, you know, maybe tending the land looks different for you. Maybe you live in the city. Okay, well, I don't live in the city. So it's going to look very different for you. Maybe you live in a place where you can hunt hogs like I do, or hunt some other invasive species like I do. Maybe you live in a place where you can actually go out. Maybe you own loads of land. You can actually help to reshape the plant life. Maybe there are too many trees along the riverfront. Maybe there are too few. Maybe there is an invasive weed that's coming in, and there's a way that you can help manage that. But this land needs all of us, and civilization is not going to stop destroying it. Civilization is inherently destructive. And I understand we can't get away from civilization completely right now. That would be a disaster, a catastrophe to try and separate ourselves from civilization right now. It's just too widespread and too powerful. You just can't get away from it. So we have to keep at least one foot in the world of civilization. Otherwise, we'll be destroyed. But find something. I would encourage you to read about ecology, to listen to podcasts about ecology, look up YouTube videos about invasive species in your area and things like that. And maybe there are ways, even small ways, that you can contribute to this. Maybe there are good groups you can donate to. Maybe there are places where you can hike just to learn about your local forests or whatever your local ecosystem is. Learn about it. That's the first step, is really learning. I'm only just now starting to contribute to the ecosystem in this small way of dealing with these hogs. I don't know what your ecosystem looks like locally, but you can find that out. And cities, I don't know what to tell you yet, but it's a question I'm going to chew on because it's an important one. Maybe what you can do in a city is look up the kinds of ecosystems that thrived where the city is now. What was there before the city was there? There, chances are those ecosystems are still there outside the city, around the suburbs and, you know, public areas and things like that. There's probably some of it still left. Maybe go find it, put your hands on it, put your feet on it, connect with it. No, not like, you know, in a spiritual way, but like there's something about actually going and being in a place in person. It changes everything. More bugs. The bugs aren't that bad. I kind of, if I was going to have bugs, I worried it was going to be something like mosquitoes, but no, the bugs just like randomly landing on me, thinking I'm a tree, I guess. But yeah. Ugh, dropped my cheat sheet again. Okay. At this point, I'm basically just rambling, so I think we know what time it is. This episode of Mudwalkers is brought to you by Nature Him, Todd, Jacob, Brian, Jay Sweets, Edward, John S., Skating Aimlessly, Joseph, Charlie, I'm a little bit tired, sorry. Charlie, Lionheart, Liam, Adam, Edward T, Nate, C Berryman, Shane, Jay Good, Cyan, Reese, John W, Clifton, Darian, the other John S, Fino 22, Trev, Jeremy, and Scott. Everyone, thank you so much for supporting me on Patreon. Your support is making this channel possible. You're keeping my work sustainable. Can't thank you enough for all that you're doing. So both tiers get full access, both tiers get early access to all my videos. The $10 tier also gets certain Patreon-only videos, just a little personal life updates, a little behind-the-scenes content, stuff like that. And then the $10 tier also gets access to my favorite Patreon feature, which is the monthly Zoom Hangout. It's an opportunity for us to come together on Zoom, have a nice, big, circular conversation. It's like a bunch of bros sitting around a fire and just, you know, talking. It's really, really nice. We can talk about everything. It's such a great group of guys. I've had great experiences in all the Zoom conversations we've had so far, and they seem to be getting better every time. So by all means, become a patron. Come on over to the Zoom Hangout and meet us. Not face-to-face, but we'll get to see each other's faces on the screen. So I understand it's not as good as like being in person, but I think Zoom is the next best thing. So with that, I'll end the video here. Thank you so much for watching. Make sure you like, share, and subscribe and all that stuff, especially sharing. More people need to hear about this content, even if it isn't this video. Go find one of my other ones to share. Sharing helps a lot. I'll end the video here. Thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next one.
Hey, little guy. Did you want to be a part of the video? That's too bad, because there you are.